Talk Nation. Join us now for The Pendulum with Dr. Samori Swygert, a platform that encourages the four D's of philosophy: discussion, discourse, dialogue, and debate. Prepare to travel from the past, present, and have discussions of future implications and projections with a correlation to African Americans. These topics are intended to grab your attention, cause contemplation, and encourage some form of action. From the world, to the White House, to the hood, and everything good, the pendulum is swinging your way. Source Nation, here is your host, Dr. Samori Swygert.
Progress and the accomplishment of your dreams. Now, Source Nation, let's get really intellectually intimate today. Before we get started, make sure you get your coffee, your wine, get your water. If you want to turn your water into wine, that's on you, but make sure you pass me my shoehorn so I can put my foot all up in the topic of the day. Make sure you share with your friends on Facebook, Twitter, and other social media platforms. I'm your host, Dr. Samori Swygert, a.k.a. Doc Swag, and I want to welcome you to my show every Wednesday, 8 p.m. It's called The Pendulum. Now, you say, why is this called the pendulum? Well, a pendulum is an apparatus that people associate with a clock. It helps gauge time and space. It traverses through time in a constant backward and forward motion. Some will say retrograde to anterograde. And this is what we do with the show. We have to connect the dots of the past, present, and future. On this show, we encourage the four D's: debate, dialogue, discussion, and discourse. Gather your friends and family as you prepare to travel from the past, the present, and have discussions of future implications and projections with the correlation of African Americans, from the world to the White House to the hood, and pendulum is swinging your way. Now, today I said we're going to be talking about the rise of the surveillance state. So I had to whip up a nice little intro for you. And so it goes a little something like this. Today we're going to be discussing a hot topic, the rise of the police state, state surveillance, and the living, breathing, walking manifestation of George Orwell's novel 1984. Now, if you're not familiar with George Orwell, he's a deceased author that wrote a novel entitled 1984, and it meticulously and surgically described a future dystopian society under an authoritarian-style government. The citizens had no rights, no privacy. It was ran under zero tolerance and maximum compliance and maximum conformity with stiff penalties and punitive damages and repercussions. Ubiquitous ever-present theme of the novel was that the government controlled every aspect of society and knew 100% of all public and private affairs of all its citizens, from their jobs to the food they consumed. Now, fast forward into 2017. We've appropriately arrived at a space and time where the details of the novel perfectly complement the current social climate and government surveillance. The government agencies that we know, the NSA, the FBI, the CIA, the DIA, and a bunch of others, along with other contractors within the intelligence community, have also married and partnered with big-time corporations. And they literally strip citizens' rights, invade privacy, and usurp any remnants of personal space. The courts are often siding and ruling in favor with intelligence agencies, and big words written in small print over voluminous pages of waivers and agreements nudge us to sign away our rights in exchange for convenience. The overused cliche of "in the interest of national security and citizen convenience" has rendered the pushback of the average American citizen to impotency. Do we possess the fortitude to mandate ethical watchdog oversight and accountability to prevent abuse and exploitation of such powerful data and info? The age of data mining, where the slogan is information is power, when most people say the attributes of God are omniscient, omnipotent, and omnipresent, have we given up and said our government is our God? Omniscient, meaning all-knowing. And so through the use of technology, the government is pretty much knowing everything. Omnipotent, all-powerful, through the use of military might, through law enforcement might, through superior weaponry and firepower, omnipotent, and omnipresent, meaning present everywhere. Whether we're talking about Air Force or drones, or whether we're talking about surveillance, that is everywhere, ever-present. So, with that being said, we're going to delve deep into this. Before we do, we have to take a quick break, and I'm going to thank our sponsors because they make all this possible, and they are Scott Cares Foundation, Urban Grandstand Digital, and Meet My Types Matchmaking. Now, Source Nation, know this is a live discussion, like I said, before these. So you can call in the number, 619-924-0933. Again, 619-924-0933. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we're going to be discussing the rise of the surveillance state and the loss of privacy. All right, peace.
Source Nation, stay tuned. You're listening live to The Pendulum with Dr. Samori Swygert.
Radio Network is just one of the many platforms that is used to fulfill dreams of our listeners and create a purpose that will impact the lives of our communities, cities, and the world. It is often said that great things will happen when a group of driven people work together to accomplish one goal. We're giving people the opportunity to have a voice, translate words that haven't been heard, and paint pictures that no one has seen. Source Radio Network is fueling your life's purpose. How can you listen? www.blogtalkradio.com/Source Radio. Watching.
All I wanted to be left alone.
Welcome back, Source Nation. You're listening live to The Pendulum with Dr. Samori Swygert.
Source Nation, welcome back to The Pendulum. I'm glad that you're here with me once again. Today, I said we're going to be discussing the rise of the surveillance state, the rise of the police state, and how that affects our privacy as citizens, our loss of privacy, our loss of privileges, our loss of power. As the intelligence community grows into perpetuity, just constantly growing, as oftentimes technology is outpacing the laws and regulations and the oversight and the watchdogs, the different restraints of this new technology. So you have all this new technology that's being born, that's being brought into existence, and we haven't even made any laws to regulate that. So that's a big issue. With that is why I decided to say, you know what, we need to have a conversation in which, you know, the community, the citizens, are kind of brought up to speed. If you already brought up to speed, then that's good. This serves as nothing but a reinforcement for you. If you're not really brought up to speed, well, now it can be an informative session for you. So with that being said, I kind of highlighted about there are a couple of topics that we're going to address today. So first one, I want to read a little excerpt from the Washington Examiner, December 7th, 2012. And this is by an author, Joan Lowy, from the Washington Examiner. The title of the article is Black Boxes in Cars Raise Privacy Concerns. Many motorists don't know it, but it's likely that every time they get behind the wheel, there's a snitch along for the ride. The National Highway Traffic Safety Administration on Friday proposed long-delayed regulations requiring auto manufacturers to include event data recorders, better known as black boxes, in all new cars and light trucks beginning September 1, 2014. But the agency is behind the curve. Automakers have been quietly tucking the devices, which automatically record the actions of drivers and the responses of their vehicles, in a continuous information loop into most cars for years. Okay? And I'm going to read one other excerpt from it. There's no opt-out. It's extremely difficult for car owners to disable the recorders. Although some vehicle models have had recorders since the early 1990s, a federal requirement that automakers disclose their existence in owner's manuals didn't go into effect until 3 months ago. Keep in mind, this was written in 2014. Automakers that voluntarily put recorders in vehicles are also now required to gather a minimum of 15 types of data. Now, they didn't go into the different types of data, but what you need to know, what you need to be aware of, is that once you have this event data recorder, a.k.a. the black box in your car that has been in there since the 90s, a lot of people didn't know. I didn't know that they were putting this black box inside vehicles until I ran across a similar article maybe about 4 years ago. But it's begs the question of, okay, so you have my GPS location at all times. See, it's the thing, it's that balance of convenience and privacy. People have OnStar, people have SiriusXM, all these different things. So on a geographical locale scale, we can be pinpointed at any given time when we're in our vehicle. So that's one thing. Depending on weight, it can tell how many individuals are in the car, all right? It lets you know how it records the speed in which you're going. 15 types of data points. They don't list them all. Now, the other thing that you want to think about, now, I have not found an article to substantiate what I'm going to say, but what I will say is this. Do not think it is far-fetched. If you can carry on conversation in your car with people through your car, and you have an event data recorder, a black box, do you not think that maybe audio is being recorded also? So that's something to think about. You know, as we deal with the rise in collection of data and data mining, meaning you have the intelligence agencies, and they are backed up by these, warehouses of servers where they just hoard all this digital data that's just flowing through the air. This is something that we must be mindful of. And so that's just one inkling of a thing. And so, well, do I have somebody? No, okay, I don't have a call. I thought I called online. That's one thing to think about. Now, let's move along a little bit. How many of you are familiar with that? Lights that listen. What do I mean by that? You're probably like, Samori, what are you talking about, lights that listen? Yeah, well, companies have, and then you have a county in California, San Jose. So this one is from the Mercury News, San Jose Mercury News. This is the same news company that the author, the journalist that wrote the whole expose on Ricky Ross, the original Ricky Ross, the drug dealer, and the Nicaraguan Contras, he worked for the San Jose Mercury. So they've been pretty much solid when it comes to reporting a lot of news. Don't Kill the Messenger is the name of that movie and book. But the title says, San Jose approves program to try to street lamp cameras in select areas. And so what it is these street lamps, they have these lights out there on the street, and what they're doing now is the same way you may be walking up and down the street, these lamps will be recording video, but they'll also be recording audio too. You have in Las Vegas, they're incorporating that model too, where you have these lights that are all along the street, but they're recording audio. And so they're recording audio, they're translating audio. So this is something we have to think about, you know. What are we really working with? There's, if you Google that, I think they have some new LED lights that you can purchase that do this type of stuff. So the capability of the technology and the vulnerability of the citizens that reside within America, you have to start asking yourself, when I rent my apartment, when I buy my house, I'm at work. What type of technologies are also at work and I am not cognizant, I'm not aware of? The things I say is being recorded, is being archived, it's being translated. And at any given moment in time, unintended, somebody can retrieve this data. And if they want to, possibly use it against me. So that's something to think about. Be cognizant. This is real. So you know you have that. Those that are subscribed to the Pendulum page on Facebook, I'll be posting a lot of these articles for you to follow up on. Those that follow me personally on Facebook and on 2 Minutes and Some Change, I'll be posting these articles so you can see for yourself. But so you have these street lamps and LED lights that are now recording video and audio. All right, so this is important, right? Now, let's move along. This one is very serious. This is where you have the fusion, the marriage of military technology with local law enforcement and government agencies, and they serve as an intrusion on your right to privacy. A lot of people may have heard of, some people may not be aware of. There is a company called FLIR, F-L-I-R, FLIR. You can Google that term, FLIR. And they also have this other company, Range-R. It's a system. And what it is they use these sophisticated thermal cameras where they can see into your home. So they use this on the war field, you know, Iraq, Afghanistan, when they're dealing with enemy combatants, insurgents, rebels, radicals, all that type of stuff. They use that for intelligence gathering. So when they get ready to send in their different black ops teams and different field commands and regimes and things of that nature, battalions and all those sort, they know they're not sending them into harm. They're giving them a little bit of knowledge before they go, you know, on a raid. And so that range R system is one of them that's used, and FLIR is another one. So it's these thermal cameras. And so law enforcement now in different cities, you know, every city has their own different laws and ordinances that kind of restrict or empower police to use certain technologies. But basically they can put these cameras up to your house and they can see how many people are inside, activity you're doing. So they can't necessarily see you with high-definition 4K resolution visibility. Like, you can't see your face. Like, you have, oh, she has a mascara and things of that nature. But body-wise, you can see the body based on thermal imaging. So that lets them see how many people are in there. Now, if you're having sex or sexual intercourse, people, you know, what type of body movements and gestures, so they can tell if you're engaged in sexual intercourse, if you're exercising, if you're hiding or smuggling somebody. And I can see this type of stuff being incorporated. I can imagine it being incorporated when we start dealing with immigration and customs, ICE, and, you know, now they're talking about this whole illegal immigration. So you can see that it'll be easy for them to bring this in logically and incorporate this in day-to-day technology. So this is, once again, something for us to think about, where they can see into your homes. And with this, you don't need a permit. I mean, not a permit. You don't need a warrant. I don't even have to knock on your door or ring your bell. I just get within a reasonable range and just hold this thermal camera up, and I know what's going on inside your household. Very scary. Very scary. Now, I want to move on to another issue that I want to share. And this one is very serious because as consumers, you know, we love the technology. Like I said, we embrace the convenience because that's what technology really does. It brings us convenience, the speed in which you want things, in which we get it, the accuracy and just everything. We love the convenience. And so technology, it brings the convenience to us. They market it, they sell it to us, and we buy it, we consume it. Now, the thing is, are the merchandise and the equipment that we purchase, are they Trojan horses? Meaning, like, if you ever read, like, the Greek Odysseys and Greek literature, you remember the Trojan horse, where a gift of this well-crafted horse, giant-sized horse, was given the, I forget who they were fighting, but they gave this to them as an offering, a peace offering, saying, you know, war no more, we respect each other as equals, X, Y, and Z. And so they brought this gigantic horse into their kingdom. But what it was this horse was actually filled with Trojan soldiers. And when the town people and the soldiers were all asleep in the town, they opened up the latch and all the Trojan soldiers poured out of that horse and began attacking and killing and doing all the type of pillaging and things that you would inside there. So what I'm saying is, all this technology and devices, are they the Trojan horse into our personal lives? What am I talking about? March of 2017, there was a murder case in Arkansas. And what happened was, there was a man that was found dead in the bathtub, right? They want to find out what transpired, what occurred prior to him being found in the tub dead, murdered. What they decided to do, they enlisted the retrieval of archive data from his Amazon Echo device. We call it Alexa. And so what it is, the Amazon Echo, it's a device, and it's basically like an audio version of Google. And it's supposed to give you a response, an informative response, a well-informed response to suit your inquiry. But at the same time, it is constantly recording all the sounds that are around it. And it's archiving it and it's transcribed. And so they use that to crack the case. So now you have, and so this data is archived on these servers. And so now you have where they allow Amazon agree to the court's request to go ahead and furnish all of that data that Amazon Echo had recorded through Alexa. So you have to ask yourself now, what have I really purchased and brought into my home? There's a lot. You have it in your room. Oh, you know, you can ask Alexa if you have an Amazon Prime account, okay? If you have an Amazon Prime account and you have Alexa in your room, you can have Alexa play songs from your Amazon Prime account. So you may have Alexa there to play music. Alexa, can you play Outkast So Fresh and So Clean for me? And Alexa plays, that's fine. But at the same time, Alexa is still recording sound. So when you're not listening to music, let's say you're with your lover or you're discussing financial matters or business plans, or just, you know, information that's just private, she's recording that as long as she's plugged in and turned on. Something to be mindful about. Okay. Now, once again, for individuals that are just tuning in, you're rocking with the Pendulum. I'm your host, Dr. Samori Swygert, a.k.a. Doc Swag. And today we're talking about the rise of the surveillance state, the police state, and how corporations, law enforcement, and surveillance agencies are partnering up, and we're losing our rights to privacy as citizens. Right? So we're going through just different issues that are going on in America. Now, here's another thing. How many of y'all heard about that blimp over Baltimore? There was a blimp over Baltimore. This was probably back in 2014 or 2015. Let me see if I can pull up. I have all these tabs open so that I can reference for you. Okay, here we go. The Washington Post, the title of the article, Blimp-like surveillance craft set to deploy over Maryland, heightened privacy concerns. And this was by author Craig Timberg, and this was published in January 22nd, 2014. And so they said, all along I-95 in Maryland, right? And this goes all up the eastern seaboard, and it said that the blimp, right, the blimp is in the air at a vantage point of 10,000 feet, and it casts a vast radar from Raleigh, North Carolina, to Boston and out to Lake Erie. Okay, did you hear what I just said? So this blimp is 10,000 feet up, and it's casting a radar of intelligence and data collection from Raleigh, North Carolina to Boston. What they said, too, a couple paragraphs down, is defense contractor Raytheon last year touted an exercise in which it outfitted the aerostats. Aerostats is what they named the blimp. Planned for deployment in suburban Baltimore with one of the company's most powerful high-altitude surveillance systems, capable of spotting individual people and vehicles from a distance of many miles. Okay? So, once again, this is the partnership. This is the marriage between corporations, Raytheon. This is a defense, and this is a defense intelligence corporation. They contract with government agencies, partnering with government agencies, and they said that 10,000 feet up in the air or miles away, they're capable of spotting an individual from Raleigh, North Carolina, up into Boston, up into Lake Erie, which is in the Great Lakes. So this is tremendous, tremendous. The question I would like to know, since they said that, and this is what really needs to be done, if they want us to really say, look, as citizens, we should have, it should be a reciprocal relationship with this intelligence, is, hey, you've had this since 2014, okay? You said that from miles away and 10,000 feet up in altitude, you can spot individual people and vehicles. Well, what we'll, and this is over Baltimore, well, what we'd like to know is, give us all the footage of what happened with Freddie Gray. Ding, 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 ding. That's what, this is how you use their own information. So since you're over Baltimore, you have this equipment that can spot people, spot individual people and vehicles, let's zoom in and get the footage of the day Freddie Gray had his encounter and engagement with law enforcement. We can look at the vehicles and we can get the faces and see exactly what happened. This is what I'm talking about. So, once again, that is in the Washington Post by author Craig Timberg, January 22nd, 2014. A blimp over Baltimore. So we have that now, right? Let's roll along, because there's a lot more other things that we definitely need to discuss. Just recently, March of this year, March of 2017, you had the House and the Senate approve the repeal, okay? Because, see, what happened was there were some laws, some privacy laws put in place when it comes to Internet service providers, your ISP, your Internet service providers, your ISP, your Internet service providers, where they cannot disclose or furnish what your private online activity, your online profile, all your interactions, the websites you go to, the apps you use, X, Y, and Z. They cannot disclose that information to anybody. That was that private bond between you and that the Internet service provider, whether we're talking about Verizon or Yahoo, AT&T, well, March of this year, the House, the Senate and Representatives, they approved the repeal of that, right? And so now, and Trump signed that. He signed it. They approved, both houses approved it, and Trump signed that in the law, that now Internet service providers can go ahead and disclose and furnish all your Internet activity, so your Internet activity, the website you go to that can maybe reveal your political affiliations or political interests, your financial status, your health data, the apps that you use, the emails, the content of your emails, I said financial information, your mobile location, sexual, we know people may like to visit different porn sites, whatever the case may be, sexual appetite, sexual preference. All of this stuff can now be given to advertisers. Advertisers have all this data on you now. And it's not just advertisers, anybody, it's also the government. You know that they set up profiles. They set up watch lists. They set up all this type of stuff. So now all this data about you that has been collected is free. It's available. Well, not free, but it's available for people other for third parties. Let's say that you being the first party, Verizon being the second party, and anybody extrinsic to our relationship or to my contract, third party is now privileged to. So that's major. That is major right there, and we shouldn't take that lightly. It's something that we definitely have to deal with, you know. That is serious right there. I take let me tell you what I find very appalling about it, and what I find it an assault on financial and economic growth. And I'm going to say it real quick. The reason I say that is this. Assume you and I, the listener, you and I are partners, and we're inventing something. We're working on a patent. And, you know, we have to communicate. So I'm sending you different designs, different measurements, and all this type of stuff, specifications for our patent. I'm emailing you this stuff. I'm sending you links and all that type of stuff. So you mean to tell me now, third parties, government agencies, third parties, they're privy to this. They can see this. That means they can say, you know what, that is a good idea. This could be the next Facebook. This could be the next Amazon. This could be the next Tesla invention that these guys are working on. Let me scoop that up, and now let me redirect that into my own people that I know in research and development, and because we have more money than them, let's go ahead and fast-track that and patent it before they did. Now, guess what? Our ideas are down the drain because of this intrusion on the rights and privacy of citizens. There are a lot of ramifications and implications and consequences that we must look beyond national security and convenience. Moving along, once again, here we go. Stingray. How many of you are familiar with Stingray? So there's this device called Stingray that law enforcement uses. And what it is they have these, you know, you have cell phone towers, right? Law enforcement has now, they're setting up these, I'm not going to say fake towers. They do transmit information, but these are not the official cell phone towers. These are things that they've kind of set up. And then they have a device called Stingray that works in triangulation. What do I mean by that? Meaning the device, that's one angle, Stingray cell tower, and then your cell phone, 1, 2, 3. That's the triad in triangulation where they can lock in on your cell phone. And it strips all the information from your cell phone right into the Stingray device, and they get it all from conversation to text message to email to everything. Whatever you see on your phone, let's just say it's like it's being cloned through this device called Stingray. And so that is something that we have to be cognizant about, okay? Once again, this is very intrusive. Your cell phone, for me, I mean, it's almost like a mini diary. It's like a diary from the private pictures that you may have of yourself that you may send to your wife or husband or the person you're dating, your fiance, boyfriend, girlfriend, to what they send you, to your banking information, to text messages, to all the different stuff, medical information, so much. But guess what? Now law enforcement has privied access to this in which they normally wouldn't and should not have. Their job is to prevent a crime and protect the citizen. Now, nosy law enforcement officers can just be like, look, you know what? Well, I know this about this person. I know that about that person. I know this about that person. You, as a law enforcement officer, is not to be all-knowing. Your job is to make sure that nobody's being hurt, abused, X, Y, Z. But you're being privileged to information that only people that I'm supposed to grant access to with consent, with agreement, with licensing should have. There's no reason for a law enforcement officer to know my banking status, my bank account info, know how much money I have in my bank, no passwords. There's no reason for a law enforcement officer to know my girlfriend's name, to know what she looks like, to know what she looks like if she's new. There's no reason for them to know my political affiliation. Understand what I'm saying? So these are the things that I'm talking about. We get too lax. Once again, people will say, oh, well, you know, any interest in national security and safety, I'm fine with that. You need to stop that because you're giving up all of your rights. This is serious business here that we're dealing with. So that is called Stingray. When you get a chance, Google Stingray, all right? Stingray. All right. Here is another thing that is, wow. All right, so prior to being employed, there is a House bill, H.R. 1313. I want you to Google that, H.R. 1313. Are you writing this down? Are you Googling this, H.R. 1313, or better known as the Preserving Employee Wellness Programs Act, okay? Here again, the Preserving Employee Wellness Programs Act, H.R. 1313. This is inside of the Washington Post. And basically, what it is they're saying companies now can require your DNA prior to hiring you. Companies, your job, get your DNA. They can ask for your DNA prior to hiring you. And you have the right to decline, but you have to pay. There's a penalty involved. There's a financial punitive damage that you have to pay. I'm going to read a quick excerpt from the Washington Post article. H.R. 1313, or the Preserving Employee Wellness Programs Act, could expand companies' ability to acquire genetic and other health information from employees via their DNA through a loophole in extant privacy law known as the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, better known as GINA. According to PBS, an almost annoyingly smart and reliable nonprofit, PEWPA, meaning Preserving Employee Wellness Programs Act, threatens to sidestep privacy protections established under the Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act and elsewhere by stating specifically that genetic tests required as part of a workplace wellness program aren't entitled to such protection. So what they're saying is, the way the companies, your job, will approach you, they're going to use the terminology, quote, workplace wellness. Listen to what I'm saying. They put it in quotations in the Washington Post article, workplace wellness, as part of a workplace wellness. So those of you listening, if your name is Mike, Mike is listening to the Pendulum right now with Samori Swygert. Hey, Michael, we examined your resume, and you have a stellar resume. We like your resume. We think that you perform well. We like your interview. Your scholastic scores are well. Your previous work experience is exemplary. The only thing is, we have a policy called workplace wellness. And with that, we just, you know, there are certain tests that we have to do just to make sure that our employees are healthy. But it's contingent upon you being hired. They'll be taking different things like blood samples and things of that nature. All right? Now, if you decide to forego that, you may not lose your job, but you'll be penalized. And that's just for now. There's no telling how that law will change. But that's what it is. H.R. 1313, also known as Workplace Wellness, the Preserving Employee Wellness Programs Act. And that's dangerous because you never know how they're going to use your DNA information. DNA, that is your life right there. That's your life right there. There's no telling how that can be used against you. Now, let me see. I think I got something inside the chat room. Let's see what they're talking about. Brother Samori, what are the solutions to keeping our privacy private? What steps should we take in making this happen? Or do you think that this is too late? To be frank, to give you candor, I think it's too late. I think we've gone too far. We've gone unchecked. I believe that when you raised none of what I've been saying is conspiracy theory. These are actual articles from reputable news outlets. This is not fake news. Stuff is going on. And when you bring this to the attention of many people in the country, and you bring it to a concern, they'll say you're a conspiracy theorist. But at the same time, they forget how much data and power and information they're relinquishing to the custody of the government and to corporations, and not knowing how it can be, as they say, can and will be used against you. So you don't know. And I think that we have to be frank. No, I don't think there's anything we can do anymore. I think we've gone too far down the rabbit hole, and we can't climb out. I personally think it's over as far as that. So that's my answer. Okay, time is running down, I see, too. Time flies when you're having fun and sharing good information with people. Let's shoot something to you real quick. Exist. All your tweets for everybody that's on Twitter, and you can Google this for yourself. If you have a Twitter account, know this. All your tweets are archived by the Library of Congress. Know that. The Library of Congress archives all tweets for all registered members of the Twitter community. All your tweets are archived by the Library of Congress. Make sure that you Google that, okay? What I would encourage you to do, I look at some magazines from MIT's Technology Review and Popular Science. Popular Science, you want to, if you get a chance, go to their website and type in drone. And what you'll see is they have, we oftentimes think of these drones like what the military flies over in Iraq and Afghanistan for surveillance. And they also have what's like the Viper drones that can actually shoot missiles and things of that nature. But they've created drones that resemble birds. They've made drones that resemble insects. They have underwater drones. They have drones that are like fish. And so you now get to the point where you have to question what you think you're looking at and what you think is looking at you. This is not conspiracy. I encourage you to go ahead and Google that. I don't have the magazine with me right now, but I do have it. But it's a magazine. And they break down all the different types of drones they have, from like, you know, bird, the different bird drones, to insect drones, to everything. And so this is serious. The surveillance state is real. So now you just have to wonder, you know, when you're at home and that bird is perched on your windowsill, or what they say, bird on the wire, and you think it's this, you know, hello bird, and he's just chirping and, you know, giving these little movements and gestures that imitate a bird. You don't know if it's really a bird, or is that really a drone looking at you, recording data inside of what's going on inside your house? And then where does that data go to? Who owns that drone, and where is that information being transmitted to? So I encourage you to Google that. Google drones, Google drone insects, drone birds, and aquatic drones, all right? This is real stuff out here in the streets. What else would I like to share with you? Okay, June 2013, in a 5-4 Supreme Court decision, they won. They said, June 2013, police extract your DNA when they arrest you and have you in custody, okay? So now you have to understand this is big business right here. Once, not stopped, but once they arrest you, they have you arrested and in custody, they have the right to, especially if it's a felony, they have the right to extract your DNA. The Supreme Court rendered this decision in June of 2013. The one Supreme Court justice that I know that did oppose was Antonin Scalia, which I agree with him. I think that police shouldn't have that right. With your DNA, people don't understand. Being a biology major, we know we have what's called recombinant DNA and DNA polymerase. And once I have a copy of your DNA, you can replicate it through polymerase chain reaction, PCR, polymerase chain reaction. Google that. Polymerase chain reaction. Once I have a copy of your DNA, I can make as many copies as I want through a process known as polymerase chain reaction. And now, once I have your DNA circulating, I can frame you for anything that I would like. Crooked cops have been known to plant drugs and take drugs out of police lockup cabinets and files, take money. Well, what's to stop them from trying to access or bribe the – and they actually had an episode of this on Law & Order. They actually had an episode of this on Law & Order, I'd say maybe 3 years ago, where they have bribed the laboratory worker to get a copy of this person's DNA. So now I can plant DNA at crime scenes. And in the era where we're dealing with police brutality and unaccountability, what can happen? What are the possibilities? What are the ramifications of this? So June 2013, if arrested and brought into police custody, they have the right to take your DNA. All right? So this is serious business. Time flies when you're having fun. I have to get ready to temper this down. But Source Nation, what I'm going to do is I'm going to post all these articles. There are like five more things that I want to share with you. But, of course, you know, we ran out of time. But I'm going to post these articles so that you can read for your leisure and for your enjoyment and also for your awareness and to share with your friends, family, colleagues, constituents, and everybody else. Once again, my name is Dr. Samori Swygert, a.k.a. Doc Swag. You're listening to The Pendulum every Wednesday, 8 p.m. blogtalkradio.com/sourceradio. All right? Now, before I go, once again, I thank our sponsors, Scott Cares Foundation, Urban Grandstand Digital, and Meet My Types Matchmaking. You want to hit me on Twitter so the Library of Congress can archive your tweets at DocSwag06, DocSwag06. My website, www.blackladder.net, black like the color, ladder like the device you climb, .net. It is not a .com. Facebook fan page, 2MASC, stands for 2 minutes and some change, 2MASC. You can also go to the Facebook fan page for The Pendulum with Source Nation. And if you want to see any of the blogs and things or articles that I've done with Dr. Boyce Watkins, you can go to YouTube and just type in my name, Samori Swygert. And lastly, I encourage you to go to iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, and CD Baby and pick up my album, my poetry and jazz album, the title Porn. It stands for Poetry, Oration, Rhythm, and Narrative, P-O-R-N, Poetry, Oration, Rhythm, and Narrative, produced by all HBCU band members from Hampton University, Howard University, Norfolk State University. And also have my audio book. It's entitled Speak On It, Mandatory Conversations for Black America. All right, Source Nation, it's been a pleasure, wonderful enjoyment as always. Next Wednesday, 8 p.m., check me out, The Pendulum, Doc Swag, and we are out of here. Peace.